So after the previous overview on database recovery, let's now get more concrete and look at crash recovery. We assume that a database system had a system failure, so it restarts, and we have to make sure that the database after restart will be in the most recent consistent state of the time before the crash. In order to achieve this, we have to keep track of log entries, so we have to continuously create log information in a persistent storage, and after the restart of the system, we can use this log information together with the database content which is remaining on disk in order to create the most recent consistent state. Important observation is that we need to have idempotence. That means if the recovery process crashes itself and needs to be restarted again and again, the result in the end should be the same as if the recovery process would be executed only once. Different aspects of crash recovery depend on the system configuration, as we will see in a few slides. There are two parts to crash recovery, or to recovery in general, talking about transaction management: undo and redo. So if the buffer content has been lost, we have to make sure that those changes made to the buffer, which are not yet on the disk, and these changes have been done by successful transactions, have to be materialized on disk. We call this redo. On the other hand, if we start the system again and there have been changes propagated already from the buffer back to disk, but these changes were done by not successfully committed transactions, then these changes have to be made, have to be found and made undone. This we call undo. This illustration we have already seen. So we have a two-level storage hierarchy, the main memory containing the database buffer and the hard disk containing the real content of the database, so our tuple information and index information. We will see later on that there are different ways to do locking, and we will do locking at the level of records. That means there cannot be two concurrent modifications done on individual records, but there can be concurrent modifications done to a full page. So here, this illustration already mentioned before, this illustrates quite nicely what kind of problems can arise. So if you have here a change from A to A prime done and the change is already materialized on the hard disk and the system is crashing, well, it's fine if this change was done by a successfully committed transaction, but if this change was done by a transaction that did not commit before the crash happened, we have to now turn this A into A prime into an A again, so we have to revert the change. Likewise, if we have here a change done to this record C, which turned the record C into a record that we call C prime here, but this the content on disk is still the old record C, and if this change was done by a successful transaction, then we have to make sure that after the restart, when this all is gone, we are still able to turn the C on disk into a C prime. And for this, we need log information. A brief note on how we are writing data from buffer back to disk. There's one strategy that is called update in place. That means there's only one origin of a page on disk. And when you're writing this content from the buffer to disk, the old content is overwritten. There's also one approach called twin block approach, where every page has two versions on disk, an old one and a new one, and we can swap between these versions, so we can always overwrite the older version and then call the just written one the most recent one. This has, of course, benefits compared to update in place, because here it can happen that the update is not fully written and the original page on disk is destroyed. We will see that later on. This also depends on the way we are running our recovery process. There's one more, just for completeness, mentioned here, that is called shadow page table, that only duplicated or only modified pages, sorry, only modified pages are duplicated. And this, of course, has benefits compared to the twin block approach because we're saving storage consumption. As I mentioned, the way you're treating crash recovery depending on several parameters. Here we look at the configuration regarding page replacement and write-back policy. So let's assume again we have our buffer, and this buffer has certain capacity of pages we can put here, and here we have our hard disk. Now what can happen is that there is one transaction that has loaded, in order to access a record, a page into the buffer. And now the first strategy here, the first configuration possibility that we call steal, can be configured either in not allowing steal or allowing steal. If you're not allowing steal, that means that if you have a transaction that is loading this green page to the buffer and this transaction is still running, it's not possible for other transactions to kick out this page here, which would mean that this page is written back to disk. And this means that if you're not allowing this steal, that dirty pages, so pages that have been modified in the buffer, have to remain in the buffer. So they will not get written back to disk because they got kicked out of the buffer by other transactions. If you're allowing steal, exactly this can happen, that every page is a candidate to be replaced by another page, and this means that it has to be written to disk, and this means that we have dirty pages on disk. That means pages with modifications done by transactions that are not committed yet. And as you can imagine from the previous discussion, this is exactly causing problems if a transaction will be still running during or at the time of a crash, then these dirty pages have to be found and the changes have to be reverted. The second configuration parameter is called false, and here again it can be true or false. In the case of false being true, this means that when the transaction commits, all the changes made by the transaction are written to disk. Which means in our illustration here, if a transaction has written changes to these, let's say, three pages, and the transaction is committing, this means that all of these three pages are written back to disk where they belong, right, in the position where they belong. And this is, of course, like interesting because if a transaction commits, this means we want to have the transaction changes being durably stored, and then this force would ensure that the changes are persistently stored on disk. And if the system is crashing, no problem because these changes are already on disk. If we configure, however, with not force, then the changes do not have to be immediately written back to disk after commit. So it can happen that, let's say, two of these pages are still not written back, and one has been written back because if we allow steal, then this one was already written back to the position on disk where it belongs. So you see, like this, depending on the configuration, there can be there are different effects on the way you handle recovery. So let's look at these different situations. So we have force and no force, and steal and no steal. And what does this mean for the consideration of recovery? Do we need undo and redo in these cases? So let's have a look at this box here, which looks at force, no steal. Force means that we immediately write modified pages back to disk at time of commit. That means for the transactions, which are how we call winners because they were completed before the crash, the changes are already persistently stored. That means they're durable. Do we need to do a redo? That means do we have to go and really check if the changes of winner transactions are already stored? No, we don't have to do that. So we don't need redo in this case. So here in this box now, the other thing to consider is not steal. That means it's not possible to kick out pages which are still under modification by a running transaction to disk. What does it mean for us? Do we need to do undo? Do we need to do undo here? Undo means we have to remove invalid entries from the database done by transaction that did not commit. So they were still running during the crash. So do we need undo? No, we don't need undo because we have no changes on disk which came from not committed transactions. And then we can go on and fill the same thing, of course, if you have force here, and then the same applies here, we don't have to do redo. And now we have steal here, and since we have steal, we need to have undo, because steal means that pages are kicked out of the buffer, even if the transaction is still running, and that means we have to consider undoing these effects of so-called loser transactions, which were not completed at the time of the crash. And likewise, we can fill in these other two, and now we can have the solution on this page here, and you see we did it correctly, of course, and in particular, this upper left box here means that if we don't need redo and don't need undo, then that means we don't have to consider crash recovery at all. Now, this looks kind of preferable, right? If you're looking at these different situations, and if we don't want to spend extra time in programming fancy logging, and we could say, let's just do force and not steal, and we don't need recovery, this sounds like a good deal. Well, it's not, because if you're looking at these configurations, let's say steal and not steal, what does it mean? So what happens if you're allowing not steal, if you're lazy and you don't want to do undo recovery? So if you're allowing not steal, that means that the a page which is used by a still running transaction cannot get evicted from the buffer and written to disk. And since buffer content is limited, it means that we limit parallelism, because there cannot be too many transactions running at the same time, in particular if they're accessing many pages. What about force versus not force? Here we say we are forcing, so we don't need to have redo. What is better, force or not force? Well, similarly here, we can say we have force and then we don't need redo. It sounds promising, but what does force mean? Force means that if you have a change done in the buffer on one specific page, and if the transaction is committing, you're immediately writing back this page to disk. That means at every commit, there are one or multiple pages for this transaction that are written back to disk, and since they cannot be assumed to be placed next to each other, we have to pay random I/O, so it's expensive writing to disk for each of these pages. However, if we are not allowing, or we say not force, we don't enforcing writing back to disk, that means that the pages remain in the buffer and they can potentially be used also by other transactions, and this is good, because this is exactly the reason why we want to have database buffer management. So, and in the following, we will look at the most performant setup, which is not forcing, but allowing to steal, which means that we end up here looking at redo and undo being necessary for our database recovery. We assume further that write operations to pages are atomic, so they happen in one shot. So we look at the following system configuration. As mentioned already, we allow steal, so dirty pages can be written to disk requiring undo. We look at not force, so modified pages do not have to be written back to disk immediately for those transactions that committed successfully, so we need to have redo. We look at update in place, so for every page there is exactly one copy and only one copy on disk. And we look at fine granular locking. That means we're not locking full pages, but we're locking on a record level. That means individual entries within a page. That means the page can have dirty data, so some changed data tuples by running transactions, and data which is changed by committed transactions. This illustration we have seen earlier. So here we have the crash happening, and then here we have a transaction T1, which was started and is ending before the crash. And here we have transaction 2, which was still running when the crash happened, right? So there was no end of the transaction, it was running when the crash happened. The first transaction we call, I mentioned this already briefly, winners, because they successfully finished before the crash happened, and the second class of transaction here, T2, we call losers. And here's the first time we look at this so-called log file. If we have here different time steps, 1 to 16, and our transaction T1 and T2, and you see there are different modification and read operations going on. So we are reading from a page and we into a variable, we can modify this and write it back. And in the end, we can commit. It's not so important now what this detail means, but what I wanted to show you already now is that we have here, next to the run of the transaction, the corresponding log entries in our log file. And you see that here we keep track about when the transaction started. Here we keep track about which page was modified and which was the operation applied to a data record. And here, this is like interesting, we have not only stored the function or the method that was applied to make the modification, but we also store here the information how we can undo the operation. In this simple logical logging here, we have, well, we take note that we subtracted 50 from this record A, and in order to make it undone, well, we have to add 50. So this continues in parallel the writing of these log entries while the transaction proceed with their, with what they wanted to execute.